Stephen LeDrew.
Thank you very, very much, Jean. So join me now to continue this hot conversation about the budget presented tomorrow are Diane Alvarez. She is a licensed mortgage broker with Monster Mortgage.
Hello.
Monster Mortgage, glad you're here. Lorn Kutner, he's a Toronto tax leader for Deloitte. You know all about your stuff. Mm-hmm. Sonia Galati, the economist, Regional and Government Finances Canada with TD Economics. Well, all three of you know your stuff. You heard the earlier panel. We did a lot of politics on that, but let's just start off now with, you know, the nuts and bolts of what we hope or think is going to be in the budget and what it should do for Canada. Who wants to start off? Sonia, put you on the spot.
I think what I'm expecting is a status quo budget. No new spending items, no new tax measures, no new cuts to in terms of transfers to individuals and provinces. And so what Angela listed in terms of the key measures, I think is going to be the highlights coming out tomorrow. So unlike previous budgets, we kind of know what's going to be in there this time around.
Diane?
Stay the course budget. I mean, you mentioned that in the intro, and I think from the mortgage perspective, that will resonate well with the average voter. You know, we've seen the course so far has been really good for home ownership, and I think we look to continue on down that road.
That's a big deal. It's a big part of the economy, isn't it?
Home Absolutely.
Ownership and real estate and stuff like that. Well, Lorn, you're not just going to agree with that, are you?
Unfortunately, I agree that that's what's going to be there, but the question is really what should be in the budget.
Okay.
All right, so let's talk about what should be in the budget. So
it shouldn't be stay the course budget?
You know, in the political environment, it has to be, okay? But if the government had any vigor and
nice way of putting that.
Want to take a little bit of a gamble, they could really generate some interesting topics. So, number one, let's talk about what is important for Canadians, okay? So, yes, it's important to fight the deficit. It's important for people to be able to buy homes, but ultimately it's jobs. And so Janet talked about the maintaining the course on the corporate tax reduction. Okay, that's going to happen. There's no question about it. But what else do we need to do? We need to provide innovation for our society. How do we encourage companies to reinvest, take the money that they're saving from their corporate tax reductions, buy new equipment, hire more people, and ultimately generate more innovation for the country?
How would the government do that? Because this is a conservative government. It sounds to me like you're saying government should tell people how to, you know, invent something. And governments can't do that.
They can help doing it through their R&D measures. I mean, you can look back in the early 2000s. Canada was at the forefront of R&D globally. Number
right.
one in the G7.
Because of tax policy?
Tax policy. The dollar helped, but tax policy for sure. Okay, and so here we are almost 10 years later, and we're number two in the G7. Well, we've dropped down considerably in terms of, providing new changes. It's been the same policy over the last several years. And there's 37 countries in the world that now have an R&D tax regime. And so there's a lot of competition. We're a global environment, right? We're not insulated anymore. And we need to attract the best, the brightest.
Would that, everybody agrees, I'm sure, with that you attract the best and the brightest, but would that not cost some money? Would that not, you know, increase the deficit?
You know, if you only look at the fact that the government's going to give up some tax revenues by providing tax credits, the answer would be yes. But the question is, what's the outcome of providing that innovation? How exciting can it be to have entrepreneurs and big companies do way more R&D than they did, create the jobs, people have more money, they're buying more things, it's a snowball.
There you go. Sonia. What do you say about that?
Well, as an economist, I'm going to pick, obviously, things that are going to boost our productivity. So things that are going to boost long-term economic growth and productivity, research, innovation, those are all at the top of my list. I think that what we are seeing was 2 years worth of stimulus. The government said it was temporary stimulus, and that's going to be waning off. I agree with that measure completely. There are certainly, in terms of the key themes coming out tomorrow, we do expect there are going to be funds for research, and that's going to boost what Lorn has said in terms of moving to the next stage and working on those long-term growth. But I think when you take a look at the fiscal picture that is coming out of the government based on TD's analysis, they are doing better off. So you can have some of those types of measures added on without significantly changing the deficit profile of the government.
Lorn?
I agree totally with that.
You're not supposed to all be in agreement on this. This is no good.
I agree with that point. Okay, so
watch it. I'll start asking you about the election.
Please, anything but that. But what also concerns Canadians, okay? We have a lot of baby boomers that are retiring.
Right.
And the problems that many are facing as they go into retirement is they finally come to the realization that, oh my God, I don't have enough to live on. I don't have enough to maintain the same lifestyle that I'm accustomed to. So what's the government going to do to assist retirees as they enter their enjoyable years, say.
Lorn, why should the government have anything to do with that at all? I mean, don't we as a society we have to get away from this, you know, retiring at 53 and living for 40 years and having the next generation pay for that?
Absolutely. I'm not talking about retiring at 53. I'm talking about the baby boomers who are now 65, and over the next 10 years, that whole generation is basically going to retire.
Maybe they should retire at 75 or 80.
That's not bad. If their jobs are there for them to take, absolutely, it'd be wonderful.
Diane, what do you think? Is that a popular measure, if everybody has to work till they're 75?
I think that we're seeing more people work, and some people are working more than one job to, you know, just to keep up with their shelter. And
very good point. One, they have to work, and the other thing is that people are finding retirement somewhat boring.
That's
you can
right.
only golf so often.
Yeah. No, that's
so I'm told. I don't know.
And again, you know, the whole budget is being positioned around employment, and that relates to everybody. So, you know, everybody from 18 to 75 can relate to that very issue. So it's
we're
very
well
positioned. We're curing
all society's ills on this show. We're going to take a break, and we're going to come back with more about the budget tomorrow and how it's going to impact you. Stay with us.
Breaking news on...
CTV.ca. Watch more of your favorite shows online at CTV.ca. Keep watching.
CP24, Toronto's breaking news.
Welcome back. We're talking about the federal budget tomorrow. That means money. It means money maybe in your pocket, maybe out of your pocket. Let's just get back and talk about retirement. That's where we ended off. And we talked about corporate tax at the beginning. What about personal tax? Who wants to weigh in on that one first?
Let me start.
Go.
So the government's focused on corporate tax for the longest time.
Right.
There hasn't been a change in the top personal tax rate since the late 1980s.
And why not?
I think because they're focusing totally on corporate taxation. They
but corporations don't vote. It's people that vote. I mean, if they gave a tax, you know, break, I assume you're talking about tax break and not higher taxes, Lorn.
I'm talking about increasing the marginal rates. So right now the rates go 0 to 41, 41 to 82, 82 to 127, and then over that's the top rate. Well, when you look at many people working today, a lot of people are making more than that amount, and the top rate in Ontario is 46.5%. Okay, that's a high tax burden when you compare with other countries around the world. So how do we attract individuals from other countries who we need to fill the gap as the baby boomers retire, going back to our retirement, there's mm-hmm. a gap there. How do we fill that gap? We can't get it from here. You know, maybe we can induce families to have more children, but it'll take a long time for them to get into the workforce. So we have to look to countries around the world, and we need to provide a competitive tax system, personal tax system, so those individuals, well-trained, well-educated, innovative, entrepreneurial, will come to Canada.
But it's highly unlikely the government's going to do that tomorrow.
Not likely they'll do it tomorrow.
Because Angelo said it wasn't in the budget.
Right.
But,
exactly.
I mean, but the other thing is, though, I mean, when you talk about the very, very high incomes, what about a higher tax rate for someone who, you know, after they make $2 million a year?
I think that's contrary to ultimately trying to encourage people to, number one, promote the economy. Number two is attract people from other countries. You don't want this to be the worst place to earn lots of money. As long as the tax system is fair, if you reduce the top bracket, you'll have less people cheating. I know the three of us, four of us don't cheat, but there are some probably people that
do. Well, we
aren't
in the top bracket either. So.
And even ultimately pay, you know, high-priced professionals, my firm included, to find legitimate tax strategies around the world to minimize their tax burden.
Sonia, do you think that after you make $10 million in 1 year, you should pay a higher tax?
In comparison to 127,000, yeah. In terms of the economic principles behind that, yes.
I agree. I'm glad you're not all agreeing then. We're coming to you.
I agree with Lauren's principle in terms of making personal income taxes more competitive and that drawing international visitors and immigrants to the country. But in terms of the context right now, and in terms of, because what we're here right now is setting up tomorrow's budget, we are in a situation where the federal government is in a deficit of over $100 billion over the next 5 to 6 years. You take a look at current polls show that deficit reduction is only at the top fourth priority right now. And that's because when you take a look in terms of the comparison between the Canadian governments and other governments like the US, like the UK, is certainly a much more pressing issue. So I agree that in terms of the longer term, we could take a look at the public policy issue of personal income taxes. But I think right now the economy and the deficit situation should be at the top of our priority list.
But you know, it's not only tax, but it's also growing, because the United States is increasingly closing its doors, as Hillary Clinton says, security first. And all the best and the brightest that used to be attracted from around the world to the States can't get in anymore. So maybe Canada should take advantage of that. Certainly mm-hmm. would help in the housing industry.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. But, you know, I think we need to focus on the average citizen as well when it comes to a tax break. And we need to make sure that we keep the economy going and have them spending some money on their principal residence. And we had some success with the renovation program that the government had introduced. And I think we need to revisit that and keep that going. I think there's something in this budget that's just around the green, the idea of renovating your home for green purposes. But I think that needs to be taken a step further just to keep them moving. So if they're not moving up, at least they're moving on.
Do you think it's something that the provincial government should talk about? Because they're going to bring down a budget a week from now.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. We hope to see something in that one as well.
So, Lorn, how about that idea?
It's okay, but I think
that's not exactly a rousing endorsement on that one, but it's okay. It's not bad.
Yeah, it's a 6.5 or 7. No, I'm just kidding. The bottom line is that the government has tweaked the middle brackets, those middle income tax earners for the last 10 years, okay? Yep. And it's time to provide relief to the top tax payers in this country that ultimately spend the money that keep the economy going. And listen, I'm all in favor of helping the lower brackets, but I think the governments have done that for the last few years, and they've done it well. But I think that they need to change the focus.
Do you think then that a conservative government can do that? It's almost like, you know, Nixon going to China years ago. I mean, an NDP government, should there ever be one in federally, could do that and not have a problem. But the conservative government does that. Everybody, can you imagine the ads right now?
Mm-hmm.
Attack ads today would be nothing compared to what's out. You know, those conservatives helping their own kind. You make $2 million, you get a tax break. Sonia?
I think we're focusing especially on the federal government just because the budget is tomorrow. But I think that it is a combined effort in terms of provincial governments and federal governments.
Do you want them to work together?
I do. I like them to work together. I think it is public policy that we're talking about.
Yes.
And it should be, forgive my naivete and innocence, it should be a neutral and not necessarily a party decision. It should be in terms of the good for the economy going forward.
I don't think anybody would question that. No. As far as the reality, though, Lorn?
It doesn't work like that. We're not in our utopia. And that, I agree with you. That would be great in a perfect society, but we don't exist in it. And, I mean, just look what's happened over the last 2 weeks in Ottawa. And you clearly see that everybody is fighting. I mean, your last guest talked about the train has left the station. Is there any ability to stop the train at this point?
Take away your financial hats for a moment and talk to me as citizens. We have about a minute left. And bring up the point that Robin brought up. It's that they're just so scrapping. They're just so nasty. We have to have an election sort of to cleanse the House of Commons. What do you think about that? What's your first reaction to that, Dan?
No, I don't see that. I'm back to the whole stay the course. We're moving along swiftly. And I just don't see that perspective.
Lorn?
It makes me sick to my stomach to realize that we're going to go through another election, hundreds of millions of dollars being spent. Government stops for 6 weeks or 8 weeks. As you indicate, we have momentum. And all of a sudden, we're going to stop it to go through this silly exercise where we're likely going to have another minority government in early May.
Yeah.
Sonia?
And I take a look at the economic context. We just came out of the worst recession since World War II. You take a look at that, we're doing quite well. But you take a look at the risks that are out there, you take a look at Japan, you take a look at Europe, you take a look at what's happening in the U.S., and we're doing quite well. And if you want to add political uncertainty to that, that's just another risk. And I'm not quite sure if we need to deal with that at this particular moment.
So that said, though, we'll probably have one anyway.
Probably will. But we can't lose sight of the certainty. Even, like, you know, I feel like I'm here for the average Joe, which wasn't what I intended to do, but we can't lose sight of that.
Okay, well, I can't lose sight of the fact that I'm out of time. I want to thank the three of you very much for coming in. You've been a terrific panel and talking about the budget tomorrow. And it's been great having you here. So thank you very
much.
Thank you. We're going to take a break. And when we come back, what were they thinking? A few of them that you're going to really enjoy. Stay with us.